Hey everyone, I'm just gonna do some Risk of Rain tonight. Mostly because I've been playing this game a little bit a lot, and so I wanna just play it for a little bit with you guys online here. Not online, just wanna play it here live. We're gonna be doing some standard Rainstorm runs because I'm terrible at this game. I'm gonna do Artifact of Command because I always play with Artifact of Command on. Playing as Commando, I might do another run as Huntress if I'm still feeling up to wanting to keep streaming. Because as I said in my tweet earlier, if you follow me on Twitter, I now that I remember that I forgot to post. Done. If you guys follow me on Twitter, you guys know that I said I was kind of tired, so I probably won't be streaming for very long tonight. And you won't be having a very long video on YouTube when this gets uploaded on Monday. Well, tomorrow. In my time zone. Because it's Sunday over here. As we remember, as you guys probably know, I do stream Sundays. If you guys follow my YouTube channel, that is. I got hit by a wisp. Here it is. Shit, I'm getting swarmed. There we go. That's a bit more manageable. Now, if I was, the player I was a couple months ago, I wouldn't have got out of that situation. Did I forget to turn on the music again? Shit. Okay, I'm gonna go turn the music. I usually play this with my Spotify music on. So. Sorry about that. For our green, we're gonna take a Praetorian Stinks. Well, sometimes it's Spotify and sometimes it's I'm listening to my friends on Discord, because usually we also listen to music through Discord, because our server has the bot that plays music, and you give it the command. It's a really nice bot. For our second green, we're gonna take a Harvester Scythe. So for my main strategy on this game is I like to build crits, because getting crit hits, it's always fun. So Praetorian Stinks gives you an increase in attack speed if you get a critical. And Harvester Scythe gives you health if you get a critical. This one's increased crit chance with the Lensmaker's glasses. Also, in case you guys haven't already saw, I don't really play this with any. I play this vanilla without mods. Not because I don't like mods, it's just I don't know how to install them. There's that, and none of my friends really play with mods either, so. There's nothing wrong with modding this game either. Like, there are some really cool mods out there. I think I'm not gonna be able to get the teleporter charged in time because all this shit happening. Okay, I'm trying to get charged in before in under 5 minutes. And roll. At least these Beetle Guards can stop spawning now because the Beetle Queen's gone. Finally. Oh god. That was just horrendous. Well, this stream is probably gonna end up, this video and stream is probably gonna end up looking horrendous, but I don't give a fuck. I'm just here to have fun. There's that, and I won't be streaming this game too often either, so don't get too intrigued with it. There we go, Commando Godspeed. Alright, so with Survivors of the Void, which is the expansion pack I'm playing right now, I always like taking the shipping request forms because of the fact you get free items every single floor, or every single like new level, you get a choice of a free item. But if you have an equipment barrel, you can get two, which we do have an equipment barrel right here. So another really fun thing about this is it gives you the ability to get the executive card, which is, like I said, it's a really neat item. When you buy chests, you get money back, and you have the ability to purchase stuff through multiple terminal shops, which you won't see any of these in this run because of the fact that I'm playing on command, artifact of command runs, but in non-artifact command runs, there are multi-shop terminals that you can buy items, and this will keep them open. But the funny thing about the shipping request form terminals is that they count as multi-shop terminals, so you can actually literally get two items for free every single floor. So I do also want to talk about, there's this funny thing that was going on. So when Risk of Rain 2's DLC first dropped, like a lot of other things, it wasn't, you know, the most polished DLC available. Or even like game. It wasn't the most polished thing ever. There were bugs, which, like I said, it's going to be expected, especially on, you know, release day, that there's going to be a bug or two that might happen. So there was a few bugs, like one of them in particular made to where the locked boxes will always grant you a guaranteed legendary item, which are red colored items, which we'll get more into item pools as we go on. But it was guaranteed like red items if you got the locked boxes, but that's been patched since. But an artifact of command, there is a green item called regenerative scrap that my friends and I all thought was, you know, had no purpose to exist on an artifact of command. It was a worthless item. But as it turns out, regenerative scrap does actually have a use. There's these things called cauldrons, which if I manage to get a new altar and go show you guys the lunar item pool, you can actually get a hold of, you can actually use regenerative scrap in artifact of command runs to get free red items as long as you're able to grab 5 regenerative scraps. Because upon using 5 scrap, you get every 5 green items, you get a red item. And getting up that scrap gives you free reds. So, and in the next floor, your green, your regenerative scrap comes back. Hence why it's called regenerative scrap. Alright, so here we are in the wetlands. These things have a tendency to spawn jellyfish, which are arguably my least favorite enemy in this game. For this run, I'm also going to be like doing a loop before we end it. Just because looping is always fun, and you get a lot more crap out of your run if you do a loop. Which, if you don't know how to do a loop, like if this is like your first time playing Risk of Rain or whatever, I'll show you guys how to do a loop. As far as the artifacts go, I probably won't be getting an artifact this run, but there are like plenty of different videos on showing you how to get artifacts. Like, I might just show you guys how to get artifact of command so you guys can do command runs if you don't have artifact of command, or if you want to consider downloading this game off of Steam. It's really a fun game. Like, this is the sequel to the original Risk of Rain, which, for those who don't know, which I didn't know until a little while later on, Risk of Rain 1 was actually a 2D platformer, and it is a fuckload lot harder than Risk of Rain 2. I never played Risk of Rain 1. I didn't even know, like, much about Risk of Rain 1 until after I, like, started thinking about items that existed in Risk of Rain, and I wondered what they were in Risk of Rain 2, if any of them, you know, made it to the second game. Because I know that Tougher Times, which is a white item, I'll show, like, what Tougher Times looks like here in a minute. Oh, if I can get a white. But I know that Tougher Times existed, and I thought there's like a Tough Times in Risk of Rain 1 or something. And there's actually some references to Risk of Rain 1 in Risk of Rain 2. Granted, those are in the new altar area, but, well, one of them in particular I know of is... Ooh, Lunar Coin. Lunar coins, how you get the new, how you use the new altars. You have to have coins to be able to spend up there. Spend there. I think here in a minute I'm gonna go. Well, I think my next screen I'm gonna grab a Hapu feather, or Hopu feather, because Hopu Games is the one that made this. Seriously though, this game is really a lot of fun. This isn't sponsored in any way by them, or by any means. Also, I should probably mention that, just in case anyone, you know, was curious. I mean, it's not a sponsored thing. I really wanted to play Risk of Rain 2 on stream. Mostly because I'm kind of, like, getting burnt out through, like, my interests on just about anything nowadays. But Risk of Rain 2 kind of, like, sounded like it would be fun to play. There's that, and I wanted you guys to have something different to get a break from the monotony. Or just because, you know, because I can. That sort of like thing. Just because I can play Risk of Rain 2 on stream means that there probably would be inevitably one day where I was going to. I did actually mention something about doing it one time before on my Twitter, and how, you know, you guys could watch how bad I am. Soft Lumerian. Alright, so these lizard guys that are shooting fire at us are called Lumerians. These are called Beetles. I believe they're the Beetles. Because the upgraded version of those guys is Beetle Guards. But there are some really fun mods for this game. Like, one of them... I only know about the mods because I watched Wooly Games cover a couple of them. He's a really good, Wooly is a really good, Risk of Rain streamer. I was watching a couple of his runs. Like, one of them was his whole thing of unlocking everything in one run for one character. Some of them I saw for his mod videos. And I thought it was really interesting for one mod where, after so much time passes, enemies upgrade to their stronger versions. Google. Should really stop saying that, or else I have to start paying my friend royalties for that. He made a joke about that one night. I thought it was just kind of funny. So. Okay, that jellyfish over there. Yeah, I usually spend a lot more time on stages than I probably should be spending on them, but it's because I like to loot the entirety of the place before I move on. Because I feel like if I don't have enough items, I'm not strong enough. And I'll get my ass beat, like I'm inevitably going to anyway. So here's our shipping request thing. So these terminals will usually have, like, a green and a white, or a green and a red, or two reds, or two whites, or two greens. And with the executive's credit card, or the executive card, we can actually get both of those greens for free. Or normally we can only have one. So I'm going to go ahead and grab two more of these request forms. I shouldn't, but I always grab 10 because that increases my chance of getting into red. Which, if you don't know, the white ones, which are common items, will appear more often with the less of the request form that you have. The uncommon, which are green, appear a little more often with more than that you have, and the legendaries, which are the reds, appear the least often, but they also increase as you like get them, as you get more. So whites are the most common at the beginning. Reds are the least common, being 1%, but they can increase by 1% for every single shipping request form that you have. I don't remember how much greens and whites go up, but greens become more and more. The more uncommon ones, which are the green ones, will become more common with more of the forms. And the legendaries can become a bit more common than normal. Not super common. Like, there's very rarely ever a chance that you're probably going to get double red. But I'm not saying it's impossible, because I've done it before. I've gotten double red on 3 different levels before on one run. Where I've dealt out, you know, massive amounts of damage. Another thing I'm going to do is I'm going to show you guys a strategy I like to do for this run, if I can get everything in place first. Because I need to get I don't think I'll do that strategy, because I will annoy you guys. I know the fear of the hell out of you guys with it. Because the strategy involves using an equipment item called the Blast Shower, which resets debuffs. But there's already like a red item in this game that does it job a little bit better. But Blast Shower still has a viable thing because of another couple of uncommon items. The uncommon items being two items called Kiaro or Kajaro's Band and Runald's Band. Which, I believe Kiaro, I'm going to call it Kiaro, it might be Kajaro. You guys can pronounce it whatever way you want to, I don't know the exact pronunciations. I probably should have looked it up so I don't piss people off, but who knows. So we'll just call it K's Band and Runald's Band. So K's Band, will make it to where it's a fiery explosion, fire runic explosion, if you deal a certain amount of damage. And then Runald's does the same thing with the ice explosion. And the funny thing about Runald and K's Band is that they stack on top of each other and they proc at the exact same time when you hit their damage thresholds you're supposed to hit. And the thing about the bands is that they take 10 seconds to reset their cooldowns. But with the Blast Shower, that cooldown is considered a debuff, so Blast Shower resets it as soon as it's activated. And there is ways to keep Blast Shower constantly active, so that that 10 second cooldown becomes like half of a second. There are ways to legitimately get to that point, but you have to have the lunar coinage, which I probably could do it in this run, like I said, but I'm not going to, because I'm going to annoy the ever-living hell out of you guys, having that Blast Shower go off all the time. So we need one more shipping request. Actually, I think it's capped off at 9 shipping requests. But yeah, the Blast Shower can reset the cooldown of the bands over and over and over. So you have half a second, and then you can just cause explosions on a constant basis. It's one of my favorite strategies to do, but the thing about it is you have to be, like, really, like, you also have to have, like, some kind of, like, skill with the game. Not to say that, you know, people are bad when they do, but you have to be, like, you know, experts in doing the strategy, because I can do it, anyone can. I'm terrible at this fucking game. But, with the Blast Shower cooldown resets, you have to be able to live and get those blasts off. But if you have, you know, high crit ratio or high crit chance, and you also have a Harvester Scythe and some Leeching Seeds, like, you're just set for that run. Because you're going to be doing damage, which is going to get Leech Seeds to give you, you know, health. You're going to be getting, Renald and Kiara's Band to proc off because of the fact you're doing high amounts of damage. And Harvester Scythe, you have enough crits to have a chance for it to be, you know. Oops. That's okay. I actually do grab. I usually grab at least, like, a couple of these after I get crits, but we'll grab one early. But yeah, having, like, every shot's a crit, so you're guaranteed getting healed because of Harvester Scythe. It's honestly not a bad strategy. as long as you're able to, you know, keep surviving with it. Because eventually there will be a time where survivability becomes difficult, because there's these enemy types called Malachites, which disable healing. But with Blast Shower, that your heal block is disabled after the half seconds passed, if you've upkept it to that point. And if you have our legendary called Ben's Raincoat, you don't have to worry about that debuff, because it's not going to activate. That's not going to hit you, I mean, because Raincoat prevents all, like, debuffs. Granted, you can still get frozen stuff through ice elites, but with Blast Shower, you're instantly healed from that frozen blast. Out of that frozen blast, whatever you want to say. Let's go ahead to Shrine of Chance over here. Gain nothing. Oh yeah, with Shrine of Chance as well, you also do get money back on this Executive's card, which is nice. Oh yeah. Start grabbing ATG missiles. So the ATG MK1 has a chance to fire a missile when you do damage. I think there's like a whole proc chance thing. There's a whole thing with this game in proc, which requires a lot of RNG to roll a chance. If it hits a certain number, then the thing will activate. There are ways to be able to increase that chance of luck, because literally, like, there's things to increase luck stat in this game, but we don't have access to them yet, because we haven't found the legendaries that increase any kind of thing. Legendaries are really fun, because they're some of the strongest items in the game. Because let's see. There's, like, 5 item pools in this game. There's also a 6th one, but that's for a little bit later on, when we encounter these things called Void Cradles. But there's, like, some item pools, and, there's, like, whites, which are commons, there's greens, which are uncommon, there's orange, which are equipment, there's reds, which are legendary, and then there's an even more rare variant of item called the yellow colored ones, which are boss items, which, in case you haven't already guessed, only drop through bosses. Now, there is a way in Survivors, since Survivors is the Void's release, there is a way you can actually guarantee get a boss item, but you have to take up an equipment slot to do it. And the other thing that also sucks is, on non-command runs, you have to know what boss item spawns through that boss in order to get that boss item. Whereas command, you can take the equipment and guarantee get that item that you want out of any boss. So I'm going to attempt to try to get a boss item through this run. If I can't get one, then oh well. Like, boss items are fun to have, but they're not like a requirement to win the run. They just help a lot. There are some boss items that have builds that help make them look really, really good. There used to be a really fun thing you could do, where you could cheese the a special section of the game called the Void Fields if you had a boss item. But as of Survivors of the Void, that boss item no longer works in the special area, unfortunately. No longer works out with how it used to. Some items did receive nerfs, but then again, you know, if nerfs don't happen, some items just remain too powerful, I guess. I'm not complaining by any means. As even then, you know, Isaac items received nerfs, like, there's a couple items in Isaac Repentance I felt didn't need a nerf because of the fact we were stuck with, you know, a mess like it was for as long as we were. Like, I'm not complaining by any means, you know, saying that, you know, it's a bad thing we were stuck with, you know, a terrible game, but, you know, the DLC had a lot of, like, issues, and when most companies, when, you know, had something, you know, out and done, helped to fix us, you know, as ASAP, it was like 7 months and the game wasn't even, you know, fully developed when it first came out. So I can, you know, I, like I said, I can look past the fact that there are, that there were bugs, but these were just like awful bugs. Like for the fact that you couldn't even beat one path of the game if you used a certain item before a certain point. That is a pretty bad thing that we were stuck with for all that time. But yeah, they nerfed two really good items to the point where they pretty much just were like not worth it to me. But I'm not gonna, you know, sit and dwell on it and complain, because that's just gonna make me sound like a dick. I don't like sounding like a dick. Well, this run was fun, guys. I hope you guys did enjoy this. Alright, we're gonna actually try and do this. I doubt I'll be able to get through it, because there's a lot of crap on screen right now. I probably should took damage instead of, like, focusing on those request forms. Yep, there we go, I died. At least I got Commando's Godspeed achievement. Alright, we're gonna stay on normal. We're gonna do a Lazy Engineer run. It's only been 30 minutes. Well, 26 minutes, but you know what I mean. So Lazy Engineer is a fun build because Engineer has two types of turrets. There's some that are active, like that run with you, and there's some that just sit still. So I'm running the ones that sit still. I went and activated a newt altar there. That way I can go visit the newt thing. So you guys can see that. Hang on just a second. I had to turn off my heater. I was getting hot. A little more hotter than I anticipated to be. I might just be like sweating too, because it's the first time in a little while I've been back on stream again. So I'm kind of nervous. But yeah, I was off stream for a little while there. I do apologize for being gone for as long as I was. I wasn't anticipating that. But, you know, there was some family stuff that had happened. There was days where I felt like complete dirt. Like, I just didn't want to, you know, get up. So, there were some days where I... there was those days where I missed. I legitimately, you know, felt kind of bad for having to miss as much as I did, but... I'm back to the grind now. I don't know for how long. Hopefully a little while. Before I have to disappear again for a little while. For a bit, because of, you know, either family things or events are happening that I need to, you know, take care of and stuff. Either that or because I need to go to the doctor for any given reason. Well, this is done at night, but even then... there could be a situation that happens where I have to be glad to go to the hospital, which there hasn't been any kind of thing like that yet. Thank God. Alright, so the thing about my turrets also is that they get all my items. That's why you saw the bustling fungus actually equips to the turrets. Which the bustling fungus, if you stand still, you get healing. Like I am right now. And with sitting turrets, they, you know, innately heal themselves by just sitting there. It's a really fun thing. It's part of the reason why it's called the Lazy Engineer. It's because you just set down your immobile turrets, and they just do all the work for you. Because when you play Engineer, you pretty much don't even have to really do a lot of attacking with your character, as most of your firepower is coming from your turrets. And like I said, they get all your items anyway, so you can actually build yourself up to be a pretty strong contender and then just have your turrets whoop everything's ass. It's one of my favorite strategies to do. When it comes to playing Engineer, at least. When it comes to Commando, I like getting high damage and doing the Blast Shower Bands combo, because infinite proc on the bands is always, always fun. Also, another thing about my complaints when it comes to that whole thing of this item being nerfed. Even if I really, really wanted to, I could just... There does exist modding for Isaac. Well, there's modding for just about any game on PC out there. So if I really want to, I could just download mods and bring them back to their former glory. But I'm not that worried about it, in all honesty. They were nice to have them whenever they did, you know, when they were there, but... They're not really gonna, you know, ruin my experience with the game because they're nerfed. Game. I've already had, like, issues with repentance anyway because... I'm just bad at it. It's a lot more difficult. I remember it being there's that, and when you haven't touched the game nearly 2.5 years. Well, that was before my streams of it, of course. I was even bad at it before streams, and I'm worse at it after streams. So I'm not really going to complain about a game I don't even play that much anymore either, so. What kind of complaints? What kind of good would it do to complain about a game I don't even play, so. I'm going to heal up here real quick. This is why Lindsay Engineer is a fun build, because you have just the ability to heal all the time. Let's go into this chest over here, grab something, because... need some more items. And that can be another fungus. I usually grab all my fungi first, before I grab my crits, because... If I can remain healthy, then I can, you know, start getting crits a lot more often. I have to look out for, like, health before I do damage. I know it sounds really dumb, because, like, when you take into account, if you've ever played Dungeons & Dragons with me, which many people who have are my friends, because I don't really expand my horizons, and I don't really feel too comfortable getting on things with people I don't know, because I don't know, you know, how they play, you know, whatever. Everybody's different in their own unique way. But, like, if you ever played Dungeons & Dragons with me, you guys would know that I usually have high focus on damage. Like yesterday night, me and my friends actually took a break from Dungeons & Dragons, and we played Monster of the Week, which is a really fun game. It's kind of like Dungeons & Dragons Jr., essentially. Like, it's not as complicated as Dungeons & Dragons. Like, you have, like, a character, and you have a stat line you have to pick from, and then you have to roll d6s is all you have to roll. And you have, like, tough and charm and stuff like that. And I built my character to be, like, super freaking strong. Like, the situation we were doing involved, like, a werewolf in a cryptid convention. And, my character wasn't allowed to kill the werewolf, and it wasn't allowed, and the werewolf wasn't allowed to die on that same night. And I had my character go attack the werewolf. Now, one of my friends who was playing obviously knew, like their character in game knew, do not let me kill the werewolf. So they went and blocked my attack, and it nearly knocked them unstable because I dealt so much damage. In just one hit, because I built my character to be, like, four damage. Or, like, four or five damage. Either way, it was, like, it would, you know, killed that thing if it hit, because it's already been hit twice prior. And I was, like, holy crap. He told us that after that, you know, that hit got blocked, he said, if that would have hit, you would have actually have killed him. I was like, seriously? He's like, yeah. I'm like, oh, shit. But yeah, Monster of the Week is a pretty neat game. Like, it'd be cool sometime if I, you know, could play it in, like, a stream or something. Like, I'm not, you know, saying I'm going to stream everything or, you know, record sessions for everything for any given thing, because I don't know who I'd want to do it with. Of course, you know, besides friends. But I'm not going to count it out as a possibility in the future. Because like I said, Monster of the Week is really easy to play, and all of us loved playing it. Alright, so let's go in this portal here. So this portal is to a place called the Bazaar Between Space and Time. I believe it's what it's called. Yeah, Bazaar Between Time. Okay. So there is probably information about this place in the Risk of Rain lore. If you guys read into that, I can't find any, like, definitive source for lore about this game, but it's honestly like pretty unique. Like, there's stuff inside the game that tells you some stories about it. So here is the lunar item pool. So lunar items are kind of like legendaries, which are these red items here. This is Legendary's Cauldron. If you give up 5 of your green items, you can have a legendary, and if you give up 3 of your white items, you can have a green. These are dream pedestals. They're called lunar seeds. You can dream about one of these two areas here, and you'll it'll take you to that area when you leave this portal. But I'm not going to dream about a specific place for this area here, because this is only level 2 next. So lunars are like legendaries. The only difference between lunars and legendaries is lunars have equipment items as well. Like this, think this doll here is a legendary, or a lunar equipment. This is also lunar equipment. But the problem with lunar items is that they all have one massive curse that grants you a drawback. Like, this is Beads of Fealty. The beads don't necessarily have a drawback to them, just they don't do anything until you obliterate, which is a whole different way of ending the game. This is the Stoneflux Paldron, which I think decreases your movement speed and increases your health. I don't know what this thing does. I believe this is the Hellfire Tincture, which deals a big array of damage. Which sounds like fun, but you damage yourself in the process. And this is the Focus Convergence, which makes it to where portals charge faster, but you have less of a range to charge those items. Now, I could have bought some Lunar Buds there to like show you one of my favorite Lunars that we have, but I have them in. Because the lunar itself is one of the like only A tier lunars that is available in this game, called Gesture of the Drowned. But due to the fact I'm running that same strategy with Executive Card and the request form thing, which I don't really necessarily recommend that you do, but if you like want to get free items all the time, you can. I recommend that you don't do it because like there are better builds out there. That this is just one thing I thought was fun. I like cheesing with it. It's sort of like going online with like on Pokemon Showdown with like bad, quote unquote bad Pokemon, and like whooping legendaries with it. Legendary spammers. Not that I've ever done that, because I honestly have not. But down here is a secret portal to the Void Fields, called the Null Portal. Alright, so this is the Hidden Realm Void Fields. So the Void Fields, from what I remember in videos about Risk of Rain lore, is that this is actually a prison. And this has also been upgraded since its previous incarnations. So in the original Risk of Rain 2, this area did not like make the timer go up when you were here, and you could pretty much just sit here in the Void Fields and not have to worry about your time limit. Which, the only thing that time doesn't matter in these runs, the only thing that really affects is the difficulty counter, because it's one of those games where it increases difficulty as you go on, which is honestly a really nice mechanic. I do kind of enjoy that. It's not like, you know, ball hair rippingly difficult at start, and then you can't change the difficulty, so you go into settings and drop it down to, you know, easy mode. Like, this increasingly gets more difficult as the game goes on. I like the adaptive difficulty, is what it's called. It's really kind of, it's a really neat concept. Not a lot of games I've played actually do that kind of thing. So now we have to find where the next seed is. So pretty much out here, this void fields, this thing will suffocate you. So you have to get to the inner circles here and charge these cells by standing inside of the circle, kind of like the teleporters. Delicate watches. So enemies. The way it works is you have 9 rounds. So the first round will summon one type of enemy. Then the second round will give that enemy a weapon or an item. Then the third round they introduce another enemy, and then the fourth round they give them another one, and so on. Like, eventually you'll have like 5 enemies, and all of them will have items. And then the very final round they'll all get legendaries. And they will drop a legend. They'll give you a legendary if you can complete the void fields for all 9 rounds. You can leave void fields at any given time you want to. The null portal does not require you to charge these cells. This is just if you want to get some extra items. And you can only do this once per run. So if I die in this engineer run, I can do it again when I start up a new run, whether it be engineer or huntress or commando or even Acrid. But if I, loop, I can't go back to the void fields. I have to figure out where this. I gotta figure out where it is. Damn it. It's usually supposed to be like a beacon of light that shows you where it's at. Another thing is I'm like horridly slow because I don't do my strategy of taking mochas and crits at start like I do every other character. Oh, it's at the top there, okay. I'm gonna pause right here and regain my health. Which, thankfully, you can still regain health out here through a bustling fungus or cautious slugs or any kind of like healing item that you have. You can get health back. And you also heal while inside of this cell. Crap. But yeah, in the meantime of like my absence, a lot of crap has kind of like happened with me. It's not that really matters all that much. Like, I've finally got up the courage to, talk to some more artists about getting some commissions done. I still haven't got a BRB screen done yet, which I'm probably going to get around to doing that eventually. Maybe some stuff for the Switch channel and some like the actual channel. I don't know for sure yet, but I'll eventually get around to doing it if I do end up doing it. But so I've got some of that stuff done. I have been getting some stuff done for my problems I have with, mental health, which honestly, the reason why I was kind of avoiding it is because I hate the doctor. I don't trust doctors because one nearly killed my grandma, and since that motherfucker nearly did it that one day, I've never once trusted the doctor's word. And I hate taking fucking medication because a lot of times either the meds either A, don't work, or B, I just will forget about the medication and eventually anyway. So I just never liked taking meds. But I am on something now to help me with my mental health, thankfully. Like, it wasn't anything, like, super serious yet. Like, I would not recommend anyone would let it get to that point. But that's, I'm just saying. I usually didn't, like, trust a doctor, but I ended up having to. Because I had to get help. I had to do something because I was tired of feeling, like, the way that I was all the fucking time. Waking up feeling like dirt. Being constantly anxious. But I'm starting to feel a little bit better now. Ah, damn it. Tougher Times. Okay, so Tougher Times has a chance to block damage altogether. The thing about Tougher Times is it has a weird case where it builds up in percentage of chances. So And a neat thing about Tougher Times is it does not rely on the luck stat. Tougher Times has its own way of procking, and the thing also is about it is that it can never be a guaranteed 100% chance. Like, you can get 85 stacks of Tougher Times, and it will still not be anywhere near 100%. Because if you could block out all damage from every attack, you'd pretty much just, you know, win the game. Now, there are ways to legitimately have invincibility for a short while, which for that way is taking a item called Safer Spaces and doing the permanent upkeep Blast Shower, which I talked about before. But other than that, there's literally no way to keep yourself from like being completely invincible. Alright, so those little arrows there show me where my turrets are. I thought they were pointing out to where the teleporter was, but they never point out teleporters in this mode. You have to find them all yourself. I'm gonna get a drink real quick. Lesser Wisps have been integrated into the cell. Pardon me. Yeah, this is Lazy Engineer. I usually get 10 stacks, or at least 9 to 10 stacks of Bustling Fungus before I start building up my crits, which I get 9 glasses, 1 Predatory Instinct, and 1 Harvester Scythe. Because of the fact that, like, you're, like, at least 110% guaranteed getting crits when you hit, when you have 9 glasses, 1 Scythe, and 1 Predatory Instinct. So you're we're gonna take Shipping Reverse Forms for these. I'm not too worried about other greens yet with Engineer, because like I said, the Lazy Engineer build, we can get carried on our turrets with Bustling Fungus for a good little while before we have to actually start focusing on like other items. Ignition Tank. So anything that would deal fire damage to us, which would be the Lesser Wisps and Lumerians, have increased fire damage. Or if any of them were blazing enemies, we'd be set on fire, and the Ignition Tank would make the damage harder on us. So let's just hope we don't get hit. Yeah, so also another thing about Tougher Times is I'm not sure if Tougher Times blocks the Void damage anymore either, but pre-Survivors of the Void, you could actually use Tougher Times to block damage out here in the Void Fields. Kind of funny. Kind of fun in the same way. But every time that, like, you know, you'd go out into the Void Field, you'd like hear the teddy bear squeaking. It kind of got a little bit irritating after a while, but not as bad as one of the strategies my friends have, which is the permanent upkeep Jade Elephant. You'll hear the Jade Elephant like go off every single like second, but you're guaranteed getting a lot of armor every single second, so you're like keeping yourself from taking lots and lots of damage. Pretty much better than building up 9 Tougher Times, which I used to do that for mercenary builds. 9 Tougher Times, 9 Focus Crystals, and some healing focuses. Ah, now we have the Bisons. So next cell will give all the enemies another green item. And then the cell after that when they all get legendaries. So there are a couple legendaries I hope that they do not obtain. Because if they do, then this run will probably be over. What am I doing? I can just throw down a shield. So one thing I forgot to do as engineer is he has a shield in one of his skills. Which, well, nothing can shoot into the... No projectiles can be shot into the void. Into the portal, I mean. But they can fire outside of the portal. Okay. Over here. Good. So we got one more cell after this one. So I'm hoping this isn't, you know, anything that will massively fuck us over, because I really don't want to restart this run. I don't really want to do another run, I should say. I mean, I want to try to finish this one. Predatory instincts. Okay, this one's not too bad. As long as they don't get criticals when they hit us, we should be okay. Because predatory instinct only activates if you get a crit. Start using that shield more often. I don't know why I wasn't using it before. Probably because I, you know, just honestly forgot. It's been a little while since I played engineer. Either that or I got nervous on stream and blocked it out of my brain. Like, I'm not a pussy. I can do it without the shield. In all honesty, I legitimately just forgot it was there. I think I was nervous because I'm not sure how this is going to, you know, turn out for you guys. So we have these spider mines also. I forgot to be using those. Which the spider mines can hilariously sit on your turrets. The spider mines I like using more than the other mines. But the spider mines will, run after enemies and blow up, which is nice. Always nice. With the bombs themselves, you can legitimately actually proc off of Rinald and Kay's bands. So if we had the executive card, we could buy both of these items, but you're only going to be able to get one. Oh, they have rejuvenation racks. It's not difficult, and they honestly could have gotten a lot worse than what they did get. Bison ran right off the edge. So I'm going to take the white so I can get a fungus. Now, the new fungus won't apply to the new turret till after these have been destroyed and redeployed. Which, you can do that as long as your cooldown has been reset. I probably just ended up fucking myself there. But I have a massive healing field, so. I don't think I'm too fucked yet. Three, two, one. There we go. Saved myself. But we didn't need it. So I'm going to take Rejuvenation Rack. My strategy always is take Rejuvenation Rack first, and then take the Symbiotic Scorpion. So Rejuvenation Rack makes it to where your healing is doubled, or like, you heal better. Its exact description is doubles the strength of healing. So my fungus are going to heal double than what they normally would have healed. And all my turrets are going to heal double what they normally would have healed. I always take Rejuvenation Rack, and I take the Symbionic Scorpion. The Symbionic Scorpion, what it does is makes it to where when you hit an enemy, it automatically it will permanently drop their armor by 2. Which is just amazing in and of itself. Because you get kills a lot faster. But, you know, enemy armor is a bitch, I guess. I don't really know what I was going with it, but since we're going to use the null portal, we're not going to activate this portal. This would take us to the deep void. And Not only is it too early in the run for that, but I don't feel like doing that route. Alright, abandoned aqueduct. But this might be my final run for the stream. Only because it's getting close to like the 11 o'clock time, which I usually stream from 9:30 to 11. So we're gonna like stand here real quick and let all this go out. I'm gonna go grab myself an executive card because I like that strategy of having double the items from the terminals. The best thing about these turrets is I can place them just about anywhere. Credit card. Executive card. Alright, so my favorite thing about the turrets is you can place them really anywhere. And if you've already placed one down, you can put another one down and destroy the last one. I'm kind of glad I took that card now because we get a second legendary here. Just in time, too. Symbionic Scorpion. Oh yeah, I forgot to tell you about these weird colored enemies. They're called elites. Now each elite has a special effect, which there's blazing elites, there's overloading elites, there's malachite elites, which we won't be seeing until late game. And there's what are they called? There's one other kind of elite, the freezing elites, I think what they're technically called, glacial elites. But those ones with the horns that were green colored, those are called mending elites. The mending elites will actually heal enemies when they get nearby. An enemy. And the fun thing about fun thing about the mending ones is if you blow up a mending elite, we'll go ahead and finish off our bustling fungus here real quick. Fun thing about the mending elites is if you beat one, they'll summon a green orb, and when it explodes, you can actually heal from that orb. But it'll heal all enemies that are inside of that orb's radius when it explodes as well. So it's kind of a you want to be there when it explodes sort of deal. So these are called Dune Striders. They are pain in my assholes. Essentially, when they shoot you, they have a tar effect that'll slow you down. You don't want to get hit by the tar effect. But you don't want to be slowed down too much because you'll end up taking too much fire and, you know, losing the run. Another shipping request. So here's a couple of mendings here. So the mending ones are just annoying. I don't think mendings heal other mendings, like, purposefully. They just heal other enemies that have taken damage. Like, I mean, what I meant by, like, healing them purposefully is there's not a mending elite that'll heal another mending elite. They probably do, I just never seen it myself. So I'm not gonna, like, confirm that as, you know, a thing that they can't do. But I will say I myself have never seen it if it is at all possible. Let's try to take some Lumarian down here. Sorry about that sudden Dredagon cry there. If the microphone picked it up. That's Facebook, even though somebody posted something that I didn't think I needed a notification for. They're just part of a group. They didn't tag me in anything. Just a group post. There we go. Good as new. So in case you're wondering, you can kill the wisps with your spider mines if they get down low enough. shoot him with my bombs. But yeah, so the executive card, by the way, doesn't have a charge recharge rate. The card literally just activates. It just sits in your inventory to activate. That's all it does. It sits in your inventory. I always thought it was kind of weird when I first got it, because it just sat there. No matter how much times I pressed Y, nothing happened. But that's how it works. So even though opening these barrels gives you like that visual effect, like something's happening, I don't think anything honestly happens when you... I don't think you actually get any money back if you open up a barrel, because it doesn't cost money to open barrels. Start building crits here. But as I said, the crits won't apply to the current turrets, until I place down new ones. I'm gonna go ahead and place on a new one here. That way he can have a chance to crit. A higher chance to crit, because picking up Harvester Scythe and Predatory Instincts also increases chance to crit. Which I do also want to recommend that if you're gonna fight the boss, try to loot the area first, because you can't earn any more money once the boss is dead. Enemies will stop spawning. Ah, oh, shit, mending. I'm terribly slow. I'm even slower because of the Clay Doomstrider. I didn't want to do that. I meant to throw down a shield, honestly. I didn't want to summon my turret back over here. I was getting ready to fight the boss. Piss off! He's got 56 stacks, or 62 stacks, 69 stacks, 70 stacks. How many freaking stacks do you need? Kill that damn thing. Wow. There's the Blazing Elites, like I was talking about earlier in the Void Fields. If they had the Ignition Tanks, they'd be doing a lot more damage to us. But since we're not in the Void Fields, we don't have to worry about them too hard. Mending Beetle. You're not allowed to be alive for too much longer. Not that, you know, you'd cause issues or anything. I have to place both of these down again. No, I don't. Guess I will anyway. Screw it, let's fight the boss. Beetle Queen. There is a thing you can get in this area for like 2 free uncommon items. I think I might go and try to get those here in a second. Try to fight this boss here, because they're open to you as long as you don't leave the level yet. But you have to find the thing to be able to spawn the thing in. Let me move the placement of my turrets. And then I can start hitting this friggin' Beetle Queen. seriously have to use all my friggin' engineer bombs to kill this damn thing? Not that I have to reload them or anything. It's pretty much just like infinite supply. Like Overwatch ammo. Thank God. Because if your primary was limited to how many uses you had, you'd be fucked pretty fast. Spider mine. There we go. Finally. Christ almighty. But I don't know why that took as long as it did. That was kind of ridiculous. Alright. Max out our request forms. Now let's go find that secret here. So the thing about the secret is that there's these two buttons. They look like this over here. Hop on this button. Wrong trigger. There we go. And then there is a second one. The thing is that these also are randomized on the map where they are at all times. So there's never really a guarantee. You're never going to find them in the same place I did. You might, but that would just be coincidental. Oh, there's a chest we missed here. Cool. Grab that chest while I'm still looking for that button. So there are ways to access this area in single player without using Engineer. Just it's a lot easier to use it if you just use Engineer because he permanently presses one down as opposed to having to, you know, manipulate a pot to stand up on top of the button. Like I saw Wooly do. It honestly looked like something I would just quit after trying to do for a couple of minutes. So anytime I try to do this area in the abandoned aqueduct, I always do it as Engineer. Or if I'm playing online with friends and we decided we actually want to go battle these guys. There actually is a kind of a neat thing about them too, because of how their item that they have used to actually work. And the coding says it's still programmed in the game, according to the wiki. That'll be better explained when we find the other button. I'm not going to spend all, you know, the rest of the stream on this area to find that button, but I'm not going to, you know. There it is. That was easy. Ancient gate begins to shift. So even though this is Artifact of Command Run, I will be getting the guaranteed drop that these would drop. You actually unlock these items if you beat them on the run. On a save file that hasn't already beaten them, of course. But essentially, I'll be taking the ones that guaranteed drop, even though they probably won't be useful to me until I get better damage. But go down this path here. You unlock this little boss fight. This is Kiaro, or Kajaro, whatever you want to pronounce it, and Runald. They are Elder Lumerians that are fire and ice, respectively. And the reason why is because of, you know, the runic fire blast and the runic ice blast caused by Runald and Kiaro's bane. So another thing about them that I was talking about with, the characters being unique, is that Runald, Kiaro/Kajaro's band actually used to run off of luck. So both Runald and Kiaro/Kajaro, or as I've been calling them, K, actually have 20 57 leaf clovers attached to them. Even though that, you know, it no longer runs on luck, it runs on a certain amount of damage threshold. Which I think is kind of interesting. But, yeah, 20 stacks of 57 leaf clover. Which, I think I might have explained how luck worked earlier, but essentially with 20 57 leaf clover, the game will actually, like, run a chance for the thing to proc 20 times before it finally gives up. Or 21 times. So do it once and do it one extra time per stack of 57 leaf clover that you have. There is a lunar that does the opposite of this called Purity. I do not like that item. And for the build that I'm going with this, we do not want Purity at all. Purity does have a nice effect, though, where you can lower your cooldowns. But everything, like, your luck is, like, you have bad luck. So essentially what will happen is it'll roll to do an effect, and then it'll roll again to give you a higher chance to fail. So with my ATG missile that I have, they'll probably never have a chance to proc if I took Purity, but they'll have an increased chance to proc if I have 57 leaf clovers. Let's take care of this mending beetle here. So you might have saw at the corner of the screen there was like a little weird void cradle. This is a new thing introduced in Survivors of the Void. It'll cost you HP, but you actually do get to redeem this back. So I'm going to set up these guys here. Because the annoying thing about these is they have a chance to spawn an enemy that actually corrupts them into Void Touched. An elite called Void Touched. We'll take Needle Tick. The thing about Void Touched enemies is that they actually have a chance to hit you will cause an effect called Collapse. Which Collapse does massive amounts of damage per a Collapse stack on you. You do not want to get hit with that. And so with the Void Cradles, there's a chance you can spawn enemies that will cause Void Touched enemies to become a thing. Outside of the normal way, which is if a Void Seed spawns in an area. So the Needle Tick is a part of the Void item pool. Needle Tick will take the tri-tip daggers and corrupt them. So instead of being able to inflict a chance to bleed, you will instead inflict a chance to cause collapse. Which, like I said, a collapse is fun as long as you're the one dishing it out. See that effect there's of spirals? That's collapse. After a little while, the collapse will cause a good amount of damage onto an enemy. And since we have symbiotic scorpion, their armor drops, so that collapse deals a lot more damage. The engineer can also cause collapse with his bombs, but the turrets are what you're going to want to focus on heavier. There's Rinald and Kiaro's band rocking off. And it'll take 10 seconds before it's back to being able to be used again. So once I get full glasses, I will be grabbing full tri-tip dagger, which is about, I usually take about 10 per run, because 10 is where your increases are like at their highest chance. And I also take at least 9 ATG missiles, because I believe it increases your chance to fire more missiles. I always do that. Damn. Smoke is fine, because I need more movement speed. ATG. There's Rinald and Kiaro's band going off again. I love the bands so much. My friend does a loader build where he has constant healing going on. And since, you know, there's an ability to, you know, no longer have heal block stop you, he's able to constantly heal, and on his loader run, he always has, you know, Kiaro and Rinald's. See, I told you guys I was terrible at this fucking game. Guess I'll do it for this stream. Maybe I'll do it again some other time. I'm not sure yet. I'll have to practice and get a little bit better so I can actually provide some kind of entertainment for you guys. Thanks for those who have tuned in to either the YouTube recording or even the live stream. It really means a lot to me, and it keeps me wanting to keep wanting to do this. Thanks.